Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Green Island Baptist. It's good to have you joining with us this morning again online. And welcome to our communion service. So if you don't have communion ready in your house, or if you're maybe still in bed, I encourage you to get up and go get your communion ready for later on in this service. So let me encourage you guys to pause. Let us come before the Lord in prayer as we, before I call you guys to worship. So let's pray. And let's come before the Lord as we still our hearts. Father God, we thank you for your love. We thank you for this great mercy which spurs us, this love which pardons us, and this grace which keeps us, causes us to look to you now, causes us to worship you now, causes us to be filled and be full as we hear from your word, as we look to you this day. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, let me call you guys to worship with the words of Psalm 103. That's a lovely psalm. It says this: Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. Amen. Let us praise our great God with the words of Come Behold the Wondrous Mystery.
In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us.
Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by Well, you may recall a couple of weeks ago when we started this series in the parables of Jesus, we said that part of the reason that he chose to teach in this way, to employ stories, was actually to make things a bit harder for his audience. It's kind of a common misconception when we get to the parables of Jesus and the gospel accounts that we think he's speaking in this way because he's making it easier for people to understand. But in many senses, he was making it more difficult. He was testing his listeners to see if they were really hearing and if they really had hearts to believe in the reality of what he was showing them. Like any teacher, you could say that Jesus found in his classroom both listeners that were eager and willing to learn, but others who were distracted and who were unwilling, in fact, were plain unteachable. Of course, one of the key ingredients to any authentic educational experience is not just willingness on the part of students to learn, but also their ability to ask questions. And in today's story, which is found in Matthew chapter 18, beginning at verse 21, we find Peter, who was undoubtedly the most vocal of Jesus' students, straining his hand in the air, so to speak, and asking a question of the master. Matthew 18, verse 21, Peter asks, "Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times?" Now, typically this question of Peter has been viewed or misinterpreted somewhat negatively. Jesus himself says that out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so we could suggest here that Peter, by his words, is exposing the fact that he has a bit of a bitter or ungenerous spirit toward others who wrong him. But I think that that's not necessarily a fair assessment of Peter's character. In fact, I think here that we need to give Peter a bit of credit. In reality, you see, Peter had come a long way as a student of Jesus. In fact, just a few chapters earlier in Matthew 16, he had kind of aced a test that Jesus had put before his followers, the test of his identity, where some people recognized Jesus as a prophet, like John the Baptist or Elijah. Simon Peter had replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Now, admittedly, no sooner did he get that question right than a couple of breaths later, he has to be rebuked by Jesus because he can't wrap his head around Jesus' mission. Jesus tells him that he's going to have to go to Jerusalem, that he's going to have to suffer many things, that he's going to be killed and then raised again on the third day. But my point is this. I suppose Peter, like every single one of us, got some things right and some things badly wrong. He was a work in progress, and his faith was continually seeking fresh understanding. And we have an example of that here in Matthew 18. Peter here is wanting to understand, how can the kingdom of God be fleshed out and demonstrated in the nitty-gritty of personal and sometimes fractured human relationships? How often am I supposed to forgive people? We might ask, where does he get this number seven from? Why is that the kind of hypothetical cutoff point? Perhaps you and I would go lower, or maybe some of us who have been around the Bible for a while and understand something of the gospel would go a wee bit higher. Perhaps Peter here is just aiming at obedience according to the lowest common denominator. But again, I think we shouldn't be too hard on him here. You see, in reality, the rabbis of the day would have answered this question by recommending forgiving somebody possibly three times. So I guess in comparison here, Peter, in his questioning, is attempting to be generous. He had no doubt heard Jesus on multiple occasions taking the principles of the Old Testament law and then kind of upping the ante. Let me give you a couple of examples. Jesus says, "You've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you, do not resist an evil person." Or, "You've heard it said, you shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment, but I tell you that if anyone is angry with his brother or sister, he will be subject to judgment." Or, "You've heard it said, you shall not commit adultery, but I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her." Okay, thanks, Peter. I get it. Your kingdom, Jesus, is bigger. Your ways are greater. Your love goes deeper than we can possibly think or imagine. So on the issue of showing forgiveness to those who wrong us, an issue that we all struggle with, I need to aim higher. I need to aim higher than the rabbis or maybe the standards of conventional wisdom. So how about 7, Jesus? Is it possible with this question that we can surmise that Peter is beginning to grasp the immensity of the grace of God for us in Jesus? That he's beginning to understand that following Jesus requires a generosity of spirit. How about I forgive 7 times, Jesus? But Jesus answers verse 22, I do not say to you 7 times, but 77 times. Kind of drops the mic at this point, doesn't he? You imagine tumbleweed rolling across the classroom or wherever they're seated. And an uncomfortable silence, no doubt, follows. Because just when Peter gets it, he realizes that he doesn't get it at all. And that's pretty common in our Christian experience, isn't it? We tend to think that we understand something about the mind or heart of God, and then all of a sudden, he shows us something fresh, something new in his word. He teaches us through the ministry of the Spirit, and we find that we're humbled and we're floored. We're just blown away because we cannot begin to understand or conceive, never mind contain, the reality of God and his purposes for those who dwell in his kingdom. We are, if you like, nowhere near graduating, or at least I'm not. Now, to help his stunned students here unpack this shocking statement, Jesus then employs a parable. First of all, he gets us to imagine a scene taking place in a royal court where a king is settling accounts. He's calling in the revenue that is rightfully his. And next on the docket, he's confronted with the case of a subject who is so gravely in debt that by all rights he should be incarcerated or enslaved to a life of servitude along with his family. But instead, in a sudden twist in the plot, the king chooses to show the servant mercy. Let's read together from verse 25. And since he, that's the servant, could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and for payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the master of the servant released him and forgave the debt. Look at the text there. What was it that brought about this sudden reversal of events? What was the catalyst that led to this debtor not only being released, but having his debt removed? It was pity. Pity in the heart of the king. Let me say that again. Pity in the heart of the king. Oh, but you say, didn't he hear the plan devised by the debtor? Don't you think that he picked up on the earnestness of his plea or the way he prostrated himself and implored the king for patience? Don't you think that swung his favour? Not to mention the fact that he vows here, doesn't he, that he's going to repay the debt with this borrowed time that he's requesting. I've no doubt that the king heard those pleas, acknowledged them, maybe was even moved by them. But the text tells us plainly, it was sovereign pity that brought the verdict and sealed this man's future. And the exact same is true for you and I as those who trust in Jesus Christ, isn't it? In fact, I can't help but compare this servant's pleas here to those of another character in one of Jesus' parables found in Luke chapter 15. If you've got your Bible, flick there with me just now. This is the parable of a son who realizes the error of his ways. He finds himself bankrupted and destitute, having squandered what was afforded to him. And just like the debtor in Matthew 18, the son knows that he's not deserving of the favor of the father, that he can't rightly claim anymore the rights and privileges of sonship. And so in his desperation, even devastation, he devises a way in which he thinks he might work himself out of debt and into the father's good books. Luke 15, verse 17 tells us that the son came to himself and said, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.'" It sounds pretty convincing, doesn't it? Just like the servant in Matthew 18, here this guy prostrates himself. He implores, he pledges he's going to repay the debt. But this is not the way of the kingdom. This is not how our God operates. And so Jesus continues in Luke 15, "And he arose and came to his father, but," and we love that word, "while he was still a long way off, the father saw him, felt compassion, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to the servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead, but he's alive again. He was lost, but now he's found.'" What a beautiful picture. The feet of the father running to show welcome. Or back in Matthew 18, the heart of the king beating to show pity. Is Jesus telling us something here? I believe that he is. This is the gospel, you see, in all its beautiful, scandalous, restorative power. Church, I want you to listen here. Listen, God doesn't want our excuses. He doesn't want our attempts at self-help. He doesn't want our pledges or promises to be more or to do more. The reality is that the debt we owe him is far too great, and the love he feels for us is far too deep for that kind of shoddy deal to be struck. The hymn writer gets it right when he says, "Not the labor of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? All could never sin erase. Thou must save, and save by grace." But how does God save? How does he forgive debtors? How does he restore prodigals, you ask? Titus chapter 3, verses 4 to 5 puts it this way. "When the goodness and loving kindness of God our Saviour appeared," that's when Jesus came down in the flesh, "he," that's God the King, "saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness." In other words, not because, like the debtor, we issued a compelling plea or we devised a clever payback plan. No. But he did this according to his mercy. I hope you're hearing this today. God saves sinners, debtors, rebels, prodigals. Call them what you like. Call me what you like. He does this not because of our compelling arguments or righteous actions. We don't have any righteous actions. He saves us according to his pleasure, because he's merciful, because he's gracious. He saves us. He pardons our debt. He releases us from captivity. He expunges our record of crimes. He commutes our sentence from eternal bondage and servitude in hell. He puts wrath on the Son, and he sets us free. Just like the king here in this parable sets the servant free. Why? Because our God has pity for us. Praise him for his pity. This is the good news of the God who saves, who forgives, who affords mercy and grace, who gives hope and a future. To borrow from our previous parable a couple of weeks ago, this is the firm rock that we build our lives upon, that we hope in. This is the soul-restoring, destiny-altering message that needs to take deep root in our lives if we are truly disciples of Jesus Christ. If we are going to belong to him and his kingdom, the kingdom that he proclaims and teaches and ultimately lays his life down for. But here's the rub. This great forgiveness that God alone can give us in the gospel of his Son, has not only to be something that we as disciples are deeply rooted in, hoping in, building upon, it's also meant to be something that's evident, that's expressed, that's demonstrated in our lives, especially in the twists and turns and trials of human relationship with other people who are just as flawed, just as fallen as we are. Jesus continues here in Matthew 18 to tell us what difference, or in this case, what little difference mercy makes in this man's life. You see, like all of us, this servant lived in the real world. And no sooner had he left the courts of the king than he finds himself confronted with a situation, confronted with this fellow servant who owes him a debt. And he has a choice here, doesn't he? He can afford the same pity to this man that he found from the king, or he can dig his heels in and insist on settling accounts. Let's read what happens. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. It's a debt a lot smaller than the debt he owed the king. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, "Pay what you owe." So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, I'll pay you." But he refused, and he went and he put him in prison until he should pay the debt. I want you to notice here that this servant's approach, it was pretty much instantaneous, the default in which he seizes his fellow servant and he starts choking him. And really, I think we've got a clue right there, don't we? Actions speak louder than words. Before his fellow servant can even make appeal, can even ask for pity in the way that he asked the king for pity, this wicked servant, and I'm confident in calling him that because Jesus calls him that in verse 32, this wicked servant has already decided in his heart how he's going to deal with this man who owes him. He is not interested or open to hearing anything he has to say. He just resolutely refuses his pleas, verse 30. He throws him in prison. He throws him there, we're told, until he can pay the debt. But presumably then, that's a life sentence, because how can you pay a debt when you're locked up? You can't work, which means you can't earn. In other words, in one fateful moment, through the harsh treatment of this man, another man's destiny is sealed. And of course, we should rightly feel the injustice of this, shouldn't we? Those who witnessed it certainly did. Verse 31, Jesus tells us, these fellow servants are looking on and they're distressed by what happens and they go and report it to the master. Why, you might ask, does he use this word distressed? Well, I suppose it's because they are subjects of the same king as this man. And no doubt they've had dealings with the king as well. Perhaps they too owed money. Perhaps they too encountered his mercy. And so what they witness here in this scene, it jars with them. It doesn't sit easy with them because they know that this kind of behavior is not befitting of the king or his kingdom. In fact, it dishonors the ways of the kingdom and the name of the king. And so naturally, rightfully, the king summons the servant once more into his presence. And he lays the charge before him of his behavior. He replays the whole sorry scene and he confronts him, verse 33. "Should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?" Of course, we all know the king to be right in his reasoning here, don't we? It's probably fair to say that we're somewhat relieved by the time we get to verse 34 and this character is put into prison. In fact, it would suit us really well, suit this sermon really well, if we ended just here, wagging our fingers at this wicked man, feeling smug and superior about his unwillingness to do what even in our eyes is right or fair. But then Jesus turns the tables on Peter, on the disciples listening. He turns the tables on me and you, verse 35. "So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart." What on earth is Jesus saying here? Is Jesus saying what we think he's saying? That if we forgive others, then we'll be forgiven? I thought the Bible was all about being justified by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. Is Jesus now calling into question what we thought was the foundation of our salvation, of our security? Well, the simple answer to that question is no. Not for 1 minute, not at all. But let me try and help us understand what Jesus is saying here by bringing in another scripture to shed light on this one. You know, sometimes that's a useful way to study the Bible, to look at the wider context and the unifying testimony of the whole Bible, what it tells us about God and about man and about salvation, and then to shed light on those bits that seem a wee bit trickier. One verse, John 15, verse 16, Jesus says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit." For those of you who can remember or were listening, we're somewhat going back on last week here, aren't we? This imagery of being rooted and then growing up and bearing fruit. Jesus here says, "You did not choose me, I chose you." There it is again, that merciful, pitying, sovereign heart of God who supernaturally, miraculously, gloriously, with no merit at all on the part of the sinner, raises us up. That heart that chooses to forgive, to remove death, to alter our destiny, to exchange captivity and certain death, and to give us liberty and eternal life. That's the root. That's what we're hoping in, trusting in as God's people. And Jesus recognizes that both in John 15 and here in Matthew 18. That's why he includes the first part of the parable. The mercy that servant found in the king is the mercy that we can find in God, that we can find it at the foot of the cross of Christ. The mercy of God is not contingent on how we behave before or even after we're saved. I need you to hear this today. Our eternal security, our salvation, is not compromised by our poor decisions, even by our wicked behavior. But that being said, such security, such a firm salvation, such promise does not translate into license to behave in whatever way we want to behave, to treat others as we like, to indulge in wickedness of any sort, just like this ungrateful servant did here. Because really, truly, if we get grace, if we love and depend upon mercy, if God's glorious forgiveness is what we're rooted in, hoping in, depending on, then we will naturally want to bear fruit for him in our lives. We will instinctively want to live for him and point others to him. Evidently, this was not the case in the life of this wicked servant in Matthew 18. There was no sweet fruit of the Spirit in his life, no love or joy or peace, certainly no patience or forbearance, just bitterness and malice and strife, which the Bible tells us is not the fruit of the Spirit, it's the work of the flesh. It's the compelling and damning evidence that there's been no transformation. We're not part of the kingdom. In other words, the issue in this man's life, in our lives, is the issue of fruit. Fruit is the key indicator of how healthy our roots are, where we're drawing from, what sustains us, what gives us life and hope, has a direct correlation in how we act or react amidst the trials and tests of everyday life. Or as Jesus says himself, "You shall know them by their fruits." In this instance, the king summons the servant into his presence, and he looks at the bitter fruit being produced in his life, and he rightly surmises that the mercy he had shown him was really to no avail. Sure, this guy had prostrated himself in the court, but in truth, he had never really bowed his heart and surrendered his life. He didn't belong in the kingdom. He was, if you like, weighed and measured and found wanting. And so he met justice. Just as the Bible says, we will all meet justice. The Bible is clear that a day of judgment is coming, a day in which we will all have to give account for the lives that we've lived, because all of us, you see, are living on borrowed capital, like the people in this story. The days we enjoy, the air we breathe, it's all been granted to us by the generous hand of God, the King above all kings. And just like in the parable, a day of reckoning is coming. A day when we will be ushered into the presence of God and have to settle our account, have to show what we've done with our lives, what with the time and the opportunity God's afforded us, what fruit we have borne. And so let me ask you, when that day comes, will you be able to say that you have served the King's interests or simply served your own? Will you be able to say that you recognized and glorified his name? That what was required of you was done, that you loved justice, that you did mercy, that you walked humbly with your God. I wonder what will be the verdict for your case, for my case, in the court of the King. Did we just squander it all? Did we waste our lives? Did we reject him and his salvation? Did we rebel against him? Or did we serve him? Did we surrender to him? Did we love him? And did we love others, recognizing that truly the people of God are blessed in order to be a blessing? Of course, the good news remains, even in the light of verse 35. Yes, judgment is coming, but mercy is found at the foot of the cross of Christ. That's our ultimate hope. At the end of the day, our hope is not the things we bring to God in the judgment, the bargain plea we negotiate, the record of rights that we can produce. Our hope will always be the perfect obedience and sacrificial death of Jesus. But that being said, there needs to be fruit. The Lutherans would speak up at this point and say, we may be justified by faith alone, but not by a faith which remains alone. Yes, salvation is a matter of faith in Christ. That's the root which gives us life. But then that faith needs to be expressed. It needs to be demonstrated, to be lived out. And what Jesus says here is this: if we do not forgive, if we do not show love or charity or pity or compassion, then it's totally reasonable to assume that we've never really been forgiven, that we're not justified, that we're really not God's children, regardless of whatever profession we make, because we're not walking the talk. And though verse 45 seems shocking to us, it's actually well supported in Scripture. The Apostle James, for example, speaks along these lines. He says, what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith, but no deeds? Can such a faith save them? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but doesn't actually care about their physical needs, what good's that? In the same way, faith by itself, if not accompanied by action, is dead. The Apostle John goes further. He suggests that our treatment of others is a key litmus test of genuine faith and love for God. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who's been born of God and knows God, but whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. And then, of course, not surprisingly, the Apostle Peter speaks to this as well in his letter, which is a good thing. It shows us that he listened on this day and he took on board the parable. Peter writes, above all, let us love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. I've been reading a great wee missionary book lately by a lady called Emily Foreman called We Died Before We Came Here. And this is what she writes. She says, we can spend our lives chasing after the next hot sermon, getting our heads stuck in Bible studies, and yet completely miss the point. Knowledge of the word is imperative, yes, but that alone is only half obedience. The word is meant to be living and active. We are certainly called to study and hide God's word in our hearts. But if that's as far as we go with it, we're just like the Dead Sea. We're constantly taking in life-giving water, only to let it stagnate and die. A new command I give you, says Jesus, Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciple. The particular aspect of loving others that Jesus targets here in this parable is probably the most difficult aspect of love. How do we love others who are just not that lovable? How do we love others when their actions, the hurt they inflict, the offense they cause, leaves us feeling not that loving, leaves us feeling wounded, maybe even embittered? Let's be honest, folks. Sin has wired us in those moments when we've been wronged to lash out and respond just like the wicked servant in this parable. We all work hard at defending our own corner, don't we? We feel it right and justifiable to speak up and to speak out in our own interests. In fact, commonly, when people do something to hurt us, we tend to remember it for a long time. Or if we get a chance, we try to do something back to show them how much they've wronged us. Or at the very least, we'll remind them of it. We'll hold that wrong over them, maybe use it against them. That way, we feel morally superior. But all the while, we're excusing what is sin in our lives, the sin of being unwilling to forgive. Now, please don't get me wrong here. I know that some of you bear offenses in your lives that are not minor. They're major, life-altering wrongs that have been inflicted upon you. Some of you have been sinned against so badly that you have scars that run deep, and that at times feel raw or even bloodied. People have betrayed your confidence, spoken hurtful words, maybe damaged your health or well-being, threatened you, scorned your affection, betrayed your trust. And so when these things, these big things happen, these painful, difficult things, it's naturally easier to hold on to that pain. To nurse it, so to speak, rather than let it go. In fact, at times we simply refuse to give up the right to be hurt, don't we? Because someone has hurt us. And so we keep replaying the wrong in our head until everything is resolved, or at least until everybody knows our side of the story and validates that side. We're simply not willing to forgive. And the truth is that when that kind of resentment happens in our lives, then it builds a wall. A wall that not only shuts others out, but which traps us. A wall which only the love of Jesus, a love for undeserving sinners, can break down. There's a guy called Lewis Smead, and he's written a book called A Realistic View of 1 Corinthians 13. Those of you who don't know, 1 Corinthians 13 is that famous chapter about love that's written in the scriptures. And he writes in particular of the need of forgiving others. He says this: love does not ignore inequity, but it is painfully aware of what evil has done. Nevertheless, rather than returning evil for evil, it overcomes it with good. Love absorbs evil without calculating how to retaliate. Love lets the past die. It moves people to a new beginning without settling the past. Love does not have to clear up all the misunderstandings. Rather, love prefers to tuck all the loose ends of past wrongs and rights into the bosom of forgiveness and pushes forward into a brand new chapter. Perhaps you're hearing that and you're saying, well, that sounds good, but how do I do that? If only you knew the things I've experienced or endured. And you know, that's a good question. You're right. I don't know everything that you've experienced or endured. But God does. And the Bible tells me that our God weeps with those who are weeping. That he stores or gathers our tears in a bottle of remembrance. But the Bible also tells me that along with comforting us, our God commissions us and fuels us to obey him by forgiving the debts and the wrongs that others do against us. How does he fuel us? How does he equip us? Well, he's given us the gospel, hasn't he? If you and I were truly to consider soberly all the wrong that we have done and the forgiveness that our King has shown us, then suddenly our case for the prosecution of others is silenced, isn't it? What does the psalmist say in Psalm 130? Lord, if you were to mark our iniquities, who could stand? And the answer is none of us. But with you there is forgiveness. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord that there's forgiveness in Jesus Christ. And if you've come to know that forgiveness in Jesus Christ, and I pray that you have, then know this. He has called you as his disciple to a life bearing the fruit of love. And the Bible tells us that love does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Rather, love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. This week in our house, just to close, I want to share a story. We've been going through the story of a lady called Corrie Ten Boom with our girls at bedtime. Ten Boom was the daughter of a Dutch Christian watchmaker called Casper Ten Boom. And along with her sister Betsy and other family members, they helped many Jews escape the Nazi occupiers during the Holocaust in World War II. They hid Jewish people in their homes, But eventually they were caught and arrested and sent to Ravensbrück concentration camp, where they found themselves able and compelled to minister the word of God to others. Sadly, Betsy, Corrie's sister, lost her life succumbing to pernicious anemia just 15 days before Corrie was released from the camp. When she was released, Corrie found herself a new ministry of providing refuge and employment and help for those who had gone alongside the Nazi occupiers during the war, and now find themselves despised as collaborators by their fellow countrymen. People just didn't have the ability or the desire to forgive them. And so Corrie came alongside and worked with these people. And yet Corrie's task regarding forgiveness was to come. She writes, in 1947, while speaking in a Munich church, at the close of the service, a balding man in a grey overcoat stepped forward to greet me. I froze, because I knew this man well. He'd been one of the most vicious guards at the concentration camp. He had mocked the women prisoners as they'd showered. It all came back to me now, she writes. The huge room with its harsh overhead lights, the pathetic pile of dresses and shoes in the centre of the floor, and the shame of walking past this man. And now here he was, pushing forward to shake my hand, saying, "A fine message, Fräulein. How good it is to know that, as you say, all our sins are at the bottom of the sea." And I, who had spoken so glibly about forgiveness before, suddenly found myself fumbling in my pocketbook rather than take this man's hands. He wouldn't remember me, of course, but oh, I remembered him. He was one of the worst prison guards. I remembered him, the leather crop swinging from his belt. There I was, face to face with one of my captors, and in that moment my blood froze. "You mentioned to me Ravensbrück in your talk," he said. "I was a guard there, but since that time I've become a Christian. I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things I did, but I would like to hear it from your lips, Fräulein." Again his hand came out. "Will you forgive me?" he asked. And I just stood there. I, whose sins had again and again been forgiven, could not forgive. Betsy had died in that place. How could he erase her terrible slow death simply by asking? He stood there expectantly, waiting for me to shake his hand. I wrestled. This was probably the most difficult thing I've ever had to do. But I had to do it. I knew that. The message that God forgives has a prior condition. We forgive those who have injured us. Standing there before this former prison guard, I remembered that forgiveness is an act of the will, not simply an emotion. "Jesus, help me," I prayed. "I can lift my hand, but I need you to do the rest. I need you to supply the feeling." Corey writes that she thrust out her hand. And as I did, this incredible thing took place. A current started in my shoulder and raced down my arm and sprang into our joined hands. And then this healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being, bringing me to tears. "I forgive you, brother," I cried with all my heart. For a long moment, we stood there grasping each other's hands, the former guard and the former prisoner. "I have never known God's love so intensely as I did then," she writes. "But even so, I realize it wasn't my love. I had tried and I did not have the power. It was the power of the Holy Spirit." Church, God has granted us all forgiveness for our sins, for our crimes, in the person and work of the Lord Jesus. And now he calls those who truly trust the Son to go in the power of the Spirit and to show his life-giving love by forgiving others. Let's pray together. Father, we give you praise and thanks for your life-giving word. Thank you for the hope of the gospel. Thank you for the reality that though a day of judgment is appointed, mercy is ours at the foot of the cross. Oh God, how I pray that we would know that mercy, lean on that mercy, root ourselves in that mercy today. But as well as that, I pray that we would grow up in the ways of the kingdom, that you would enable us by the power of the Spirit, that you would sanctify us to bear the fruit of love. And we know that part of love, perhaps the most difficult part, is loving those who haven't been that lovable. Lord, you know the things that we bear, the hurts and the scars. We look to you, the great healer, the great equipper, and we ask by the power of the Spirit, cause us to be doers of the word. Don't let this message, this parable, stagnate in our hearts. But Lord, cause us to demonstrate and to live out and share with others the same life-giving mercy that we've been granted. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
What love could remember? No wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their son. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new and more. So tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. So much more, and darkness knew evermore. Since they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Well, Justin, this time now we come to communion. And this is a meal for all those who have encountered and have come to trust in the mercy of God. This is a meal, you see, for the born again Christian to share in. And there's a place at this table because you could say another has made a great payment on Jamie Dill's behalf and on your behalf. Another that has transferred, another who has credited his goodness, his righteousness unto us, so that we may sit here today reconciled, we may sit here today ransomed, healed, and restored and forgiven. The Bible teaches us that in Christ, God was reconciling the world to Himself, not counting our trespasses against them, and entrusting us to the message of reconciliation. You see, in Jesus, we have been brought into the peace of God through the cross, called out as new creation, as ambassadors for Christ, with no trespasses counted against us. And let me encourage you, this is what the believer has, and this is what the believer is. So let me encourage you to come and break bread, knowing that you have been reconciled to the Father. So I would say, if you are a genuine, true, born-again Christian, whether you're listening from Green Island or from the other side of the world or from a different part of our wee country, let me encourage you to come and partake in this meal. Join with us together. But I would say, if you're not a believer, if you're not a born-again Christian, if you do not know what it means to love Jesus and know what it means to have sins forgiven, I would say, think now and consider where you stand before a holy God. Let me encourage you to let this pass you by, but don't let this opportunity pass you by to get right with God. Let me encourage you to run to Jesus and repent of your sins and turn to Him today. So let me read you guys from 1 Corinthians 11, just before we come to pray and just before we come to take the bread together. So it says this: For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when He was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had given it thanks, He broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, He also took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. Let's just pause and let's just pray. Father, we thank You that though we are unworthy, You sit us down this morning as Your guests. And Father, we rest not on our merit, but on Jesus, Father. So call us to, in a sense, hide beneath His righteousness, hide in this great payment on the cross, Father. Help us gaze upon our beautiful Savior just now in our own wee ways. Cause us to ponder why He died. Cause us to hear Him say, I give my life to purchase yours. I shed my blood to blot out your guilt. I opened my side to make you clean. I endured your curse to set you free. I bore your condemnation to satisfy divine justice. And we thank You, Lord, that that's what You have done for us on the cross. We thank You that You have paid the price that no man could pay. and that we might sit here ransomed, healed, and restored, and forgiven. We give you praise, Father. Cause our hearts to realize the magnitude of this as we sit in our homes and we break bread together. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And the body of Christ broken for you. So let us now just respond with the words of Come, O Sinner. Just as we come to share the cup, let me read you guys from Romans 3. This is verse 21 to 26. It says this: But now the righteousness of God has been manifest apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, for For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. And really, we can praise God that his saving righteousness has been shown in the death of his Son. Praise God that we are justified by his great justice and love on the cross. Praise God for the blood of Jesus, which takes away the sins of the world. So let's drink together. The blood of Jesus shed to cleanse us of all our sins. Let me just pause and pray as we bring our communion time to a lovely close. Let's just pray together. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you that we fall short, that we have done nothing, but we have sinned our lives out. But we thank you that Christ has not fallen short, that Christ has made a way for us to stand before a holy and just God, without blemish, spotless and clean. And we thank you that we are washed by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you for this great exchange, this great transaction, that your blood has satisfied God's wrath, that your blood has wiped away sin from our sinful statement, that you alone have satisfied the wrath of the Father, so that we may know what it means to be forgiven, that Christ has paid for us in full. And we give you praise and thanks for that. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, instead of starting a new video, we'll just finish off with some announcements. Please tune in tonight, like every Sunday night. We have prayer on tonight at 7 o'clock on Zoom. It's the same login details all summer. So at 7 o'clock tonight, please join in with us to pray on Zoom tonight at 7 o'clock. And also we have our Together Apart series. It's on Wednesday at 8 p.m. which is 8 p.m. Wednesday. Questions are up online. Philip Griffith is doing Psalm 4. That's this week. So please tune in with that. And also next Sunday, GPC Kids is on at 10 o'clock. And our service is on, like this time, 10:30. A guy called Moore Casement, he's my old teacher in Cornhill, Belfast, he is preaching. So Moore, it's great to have Moore back with us. So please tune in next Sunday for the kids at 10. And our morning service at 10:30. And Moore will be joining us. Also, what we notice is this time of year is a bit different than usual years because of lockdown, of course, and just all that's going on. And we know many people would be at conferences and different stuff like New Horizon and Keswick over in Coleraine. No, not Coleraine, Port Stewart is usually in. We know there's a lot of stuff on for Christians to go to in the summer and for us to hear new stuff and be encouraged and be built up. But we just want to point you to a wee resource that you can tune into online. It's Keswick. But they'll be broadcasting a load of different great talks on Christopher Aish. I've heard him before, he's very good. He'll be speaking on Psalms 2-6, so please tune into that online. Keswick, I think you say, I can't remember how it says, Keswick or Keswick, but definitely tune in online to this here. There should be slides, I hope, beside me and some on the right or left that will show you this and explain it hopefully a lot better than what I have. But yeah, please tune into that. And there's many resources online and different conferences happen, so just keep an eye out for them. So yeah, hope you guys are encouraged by today, and I hope you've had a lovely morning with us in Green Island Baptist. And great to join us if it's your first time, and it's always great to have your regulars there. I'm sure yours are all looking well from the comfort of your own homes. But let me part you guys with a blessing from Hebrews 13 as we go our own separate ways now. It says this: Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior wore that cursed tree. His body